For many, many years, I believed that if I play my best tennis, I'm going to win.
Well done, well done!
People were afraid of him. They're going to play almost against perfect machine.
I'm not going to beat him. He's too good. He's too powerful. I can't do anything to hurt him.
I beat Jimmy Connors, Borg, McEnroe. I never beat Ivan Lendl.
Winning majors pushes you towards number one. And so I was trying to win majors and become number one. I was 8 years old in 1968, and with the Soviet-led invasion, we saw some on television. My parents were in Prague. They picked me up from my grandparents, and then we took a train to Ostrava, and we saw the tanks along the rails.
We didn't know if the country is in war or not. Then we saw the tanks, people in the streets, and it wasn't very pretty, and it stayed with us for forever. If you saw four people together, you could bet that at least two were KGB people. You know, that the system of communism was almost perfect. I never thought it would be broken.
I don't think people who grow up in Great Britain or in America can ever understand that.
It was against this climate of fear and recrimination that Ivan Lendl, the son of two national players, took up tennis in his hometown of Ostrava.
I remember the first coach over there who had little kids, starting 7, 8 years old, kept kicking me off the court because I was only four, and he would kick me out one side and I would come back the other side. And he finally let me stay in. Both of my parents played tennis, so it was just natural to go to the club in the afternoons after school and spend there as much time as I could before I had to do homework.
He had a very good forehand, you know, he was tall, so I think the serve was a pretty big weapon and desire to win. His mother was really the boss in the family, the energy of the house. The father was more like lawyer, liked to play chess, little tennis, but Olga told him what to do or not to do.
I just enjoyed playing and enjoyed being out there and wanted to play more and more and more and until I couldn't move.
And there's Ivan Lendl. Now, he's had a fantastic season. He won the Orange Bowl tournament at the beginning of the year, and he's cleaned all the junior titles available to him in Europe. He's won in Italy, again in Paris, and now here at Wimbledon, and easily the outstanding junior player of the year.
What he was lacking at the time was speed, quickness around the court. He was clumsy, he was slow, and he also wasn't a very tough person. He was a bit sort of like a crying baby when he was a junior.
Wojciech Fibak has lived a unique tennis life. A lover of the arts, the cultured Pole was a top 10 player in the 1970s and once the personal tennis coach to Pope John Paul II. In 1978, as Lendl embarked on his journey into the senior ranks, Fibak was charged with ensuring the young Czech made the most of his talent.
He came to me for an advice because he wanted to be number one in the world in the rankings. So I looked at him and I said, wow, boy.
It's very difficult when you come on the tour to learn things. And if you get somebody to direct you or point you in the right direction, then you can make better choices.
It struck me immediately, his very intelligent way of putting, very smart way of putting his thoughts up to me and his certain determination.
Well, I wanted to win all the matches I was playing, and I wasn't looking so far ahead. I was always looking one level up. So.
more experience you have and more good advice you have, better choices you make.
He has improved tremendously his backhand, his serve. And I think that he has to be very happy what he has achieved.
One of the qualities of Ivan that once he trusted somebody, like I guess his parents or myself, he never ever argued. Anything I said over 5 years when we've been together, he always accepted.
It's always important to have somebody who understands you, somebody you can trust. That's very important because they take away all the headaches you have off the court and you can really focus on your tennis and enjoy it.
Under Feebach's guidance, Lendl quickly made his mark on the international circuit. In 1980, he led Czechoslovakia to the Davis Cup final in Prague against Italy.
We choose our surface. We play indoors, a faster surface against Italians who like to play on clay.
Felt like we really were the favorites. Thomas beat Panatta, which was great. From then on, it just snowballed. We were playing the doubles, and I remember in the fifth set, nobody almost could hold serve, something along those lines. It was nice, it was great, and very enjoyable. We certainly didn't play for the regime, we played for ourselves.
Unbelievable, again, you cannot forget those moments for the rest of your life.
This Davis Cup was a very important addition to his career, especially because he was coming from the small country. It's much easier to win Davis Cup being a US citizen, but much more difficult to win being a Czech citizen.
And it was that distinction that triggered the next part of Feebach's master plan.
I insisted on Ivan moving to America immediately because the people from Eastern Europe had a complex and they were not winning big matches and it wasn't easy to break through. I wanted for Ivan to become more American. It's a country of amazing opportunities with a very positive mentality.
I think the decision was critical for his tennis because remember in those days there were 30, 35 tournaments in the United States.
Ivan Lendl, 20 years old from Czechoslovakia, whose meteoric rise over the past 12 months has taken him to 13th place on the ATP World Computer Rankings.
He was spending a very large amount of his time in America playing tournaments.
Oh, that's a gem.
There were 15 tournaments I could go from Greenwich, Connecticut by car within four and a half hours. There were three major airports. You can, less than an hour from the house, I could fly to anywhere in the world. So it was only natural to be involved or to be living there.
Lendl comes to the United States was a big thing. That to him was a way of showing that he was in it for business, that he was all business. He wanted to maximize his potential. He enjoyed making money. He worked hard to make money. And he wanted to really focus on winning big.
Well, Ivan Lendl very keen to get on with play. Out first.
1981, Ivan Lendl really hits the radar in a major way when he reaches the final at Roland Garros.
And he will try to ignore the applause for Bjorn Borg.
It was a tough tournament. I saved a match point in the semifinals against my good friend Jose Luis Clerc, which I never fail to remind him when he starts giving me hard time. and then playing Borg.
Oh, that's a wonderful shot.
Five sets, being 19 or 20, the French, it's not bad. It's phenomenal.
Thank you. a forehand, no inhibitions at all, a really glorious stroke to make it 2-6 all.
Got to the fifth set, but didn't have much left, and Bjorn was still fresh, unfortunately for me.
Time, and here's the championship for Borg.
Lendl takes Borg to 5 sets. It was a great effort. It gave a sign that this guy might be contending for significant titles in the years to come.
I don't look at it as an achievement. When you lose, you lose. And I don't really care who it is on the other side. You try to beat the guy.
Taking Borg to the limit suggested Lendl had the talent to become a major champion. He rose to become world number one in 1983 and made 3 more Grand Slam finals, but lost them all.
Lendl revealed some psychological weaknesses in 1982 and 83 when he was expected to win some majors.
I still wasn't quite ready. I lost to Connors, US Open in 82. I lost to Mats in Australia in 83. I'd lost to Connors again in 83 at the US Open. That one was hard because I got tired in the match and didn't like that feeling.
I don't think it was a distress situation. I don't think everybody was, you know, nervous that the guy was never going to win a Grand Slam. But obviously, in the press, people start making a bigger and bigger deal about it.
There was definitely a shadow over him that he had accumulated a great many titles, that he had earned his way to the number one ranking, but he hadn't really earned his way to the number one ranking. He hadn't won a major.
So at the French Open 1984, Ivan Lendl had already been ranked number one, so he was a player of repute, but he'd never won a major, and there were questions whether he had the fortitude and the mental fitness. And on the other side of that, you have John McEnroe, who not only is having this sensational year, but he's trying to become the first American in decades to win on the clay of the French Open.
John McEnroe, this first 2 sets, played magnificent, creative tennis. He was Pablo Picasso.
McEnroe turned clay into grass. He made Roland Garros Stadium look like Wimbledon.
Lendl, to his credit, he hung in. He kept digging and digging and spitting balls back and making returns and finding ways to win points.
I was thinking there's a chance. How big of a chance, you don't know, but you have to do yourself justice and fight till the end.
So Ivan kept looking at me once, twice, 20, 30, 40, 50 times. I said, so when would he stop hitting the lines? So, Wojtek, you were so smart, eh? So when, huh? And I said, wait, wait, and again. But wait, 2 sets gone, break in the third, so when? I said, wait. And McEnroe missed it. One forehand volley when he missed it down with like open court, he missed, just missed, and the match was turned.
When I broke and won the third set, I felt right there that I'm in the match.
For 3 hours, Ivan Lendl's been like a man hacking his way through dense undergrowth. His instinct and sheer courage, I think, have kept him going.
Ivan came back, Ivan believed in, started to believe in his passing shot.
Oh. Being down that far, fighting through things, that to me really showed, ah, Lendl, this guy is here.
Then he won, eventually, 7-5 in the fifth marathon match, an amazing achievement. One of the best matches ever played.
It was great feeling. I was very tired, so I don't have too many memories of the end of the match or ceremony and so on because of the fatigue. But just a great feeling to achieve one of your goals.
Lendl wins the match. It's this breakthrough, this validation. He's a Grand Slam champion. And it isn't just, hey, I've arrived. This is great. Mission accomplished. Now the spigot is untapped. Now it really has this galvanizing impact.
Once you prove that you can do it, you know you can do it again.
The turning point in some ways almost was more what he took away from it than the win itself. It was, okay, now I won a Grand Slam. Now I see what that takes to win a Grand Slam. I do want to win more. I want to be the best player in the world. I'm going to be the best player in the world. What do I have to do to get there?
That summer after the French, I still remember very well how badly I felt after the French finals and so on. I decided I want to get fitter. And I never want to lose another match because the other guy was fitter than me. And so we started looking for different things, and we looked at nutrition, we looked at training, and so on and so on, and that's when my career really took off.
I think that he was an inspiration because he really was the one that took training to the next level. So I think everybody, all of us should thank Ivan. The players of today should thank Ivan.
He was a creator of something new. He borrowed some of the techniques that Martina Navratilova had pioneered, fitness, nutrition, diet, maybe some cross training, and then he took them to his level.
I realized very quickly that I can use that knowledge. I can use it to improve my chances of succeeding.
Lendl's desire to evolve also led to his splits with coach Wojciech Fibak. The Australian doubles legend Tony Roach would be his new coach. A move designed in part to help Lendl overcome his two biggest rivals, the American left-handers John McEnroe and Jimmy Connors.
I never practiced with left-handers, so it was a problem for me. I didn't understand them and didn't really have enough repetition against them, and Tony being left-handed played a big part in that decision.
Bringing Tony Roach in was had a big impact on him in a lot of ways. Part of that was to play on grass, part of that was to beat left-handers, part of that was just to be better overall. And that was a great relationship for a long period of time, which was very, very important.
Tony Roach is a very dedicated coach, a guy who really loves the tennis and digs into matches and understands technique and tactics and psychology, and really was an incredible part of Lendl's growth to the top of the world.
The new partnership got off to the perfect start. In 1985, Lendl beat McEnroe in the US Open final, the first of three consecutive titles at Flushing Meadows. Commuting each day from his home in Connecticut, just 25 miles away, Lendl would reach the final 8 years running in the 1980s. In tennis terms, he was the king of New York.
It's a very tiring place. It's noisy, there are a lot of people grabbing at you, wanting something all the time when you're number one player in the world. And I didn't have to deal with that. I would just warm up at home, drive for the match, play my match, go straight from the press conference into my car and go back home.
Well done, well done!
I think that was actually a big part of the run I had there.
Home was now the United States, and yet despite the run of success, notably in New York, Lendl throughout his career would struggle to win the respect of fans and media in his adopted country.
Ivan has huge followings in various places around the world, Japan, Australia, places in Europe. America was a different story because this theme was there, East versus West, Connors versus Lendl, McEnroe versus Lendl. When it came to them versus Ivan, you know, the Americans were gonna side with the Americans, obviously.
I never really heard the crowd. I always say that if the crowd is for you, you play harder because you don't want to let them down. And when the crowd is against you, you play harder because you want to show them.
In the 1980s, when you have Ivan Drago and every other movie being made is this dystopian view of the Eastern Bloc and of the Iron Curtain, and Lendl, even with his name, the D and the L, seems so foreign to most Americans, I think that really informed the discussion.
Doesn't matter how well you played during the match or tournament, they were always cheering against us because we were from the Eastern Bloc.
Sports Illustrated article or cover for me was really one of the most disappointing days of my entire career.
If you go back and look at the cover, first it says the champion no one cares about. And then in the tiniest letters underneath it, it says, you know, whatever, Ivan Lendl wins the U.S. Open.
I'll never forget, I saw it in an airport. It was like putting a dagger into my heart.
You play against their home boys, so you have to understand that, but that doesn't mean that the media has to be unfair. If it doesn't fit their story, they write something which does.
The grudge that Lendl kept was really remarkable.
Well, it saved me a lot of time ever talking to Sports Illustrated again.
Lendl is coaching Andy Murray, and I ask him a question. He starts to answer. He sees my credential. He says, oh, I don't talk to Sports Illustrated, that cover. I said, oh, no, I didn't. I was in middle school at the time. It wasn't me. Didn't matter. He had made this vow never to speak to Sports Illustrated, and part of me is thinking, what an asshole. And the other part of me is thinking, there's a real integrity, I suppose, to making this vow never to speak to an outlet.
Lendl's stoic demeanor was an extension of his driven personality. And his powerful aura came into play not just on the court, but off it.
The locker room is a different world. The locker room is the world where you can towel snap and intimidate, and I think Lendl enjoyed himself in that world, and I think Lendl liked being a little bit of the Lord of the Roost and being a bit of a, had a very clever sense of humor and could kind of mock people and kind of smack talk it a little bit.
The professional side of him is very, very serious, but behind that was always sort of a fun-loving, pretty easy to get along with guy. If you would walk through the locker room, you could always tell that he was the joker of the group, and everybody's always laughing.
Mikhail Perns was lost to Ivan semifinals of a tournament in Tokyo, I think it was, like 6-1, 6-1 or something, and Michael said he played well, and he's sitting in the locker room talking to his coach and just, I don't know what to do against the guy. And then Ivan comes in and he says to Michael, I had you running like a dog today, didn't I, Michael? You don't say that to a guy that you just beat 6-1, 6-1, but that's what Ivan did.
The mid to late 80s belonged to Ivan Lendl, world number one for more than 5 years. Lendl won a total of 8 Grand Slam titles, 3 on the hard courts of the US Open, 3 on the clay at the French Open.
It's out! Lendl the champion.
And the last two at the Australian Open in 1989 and 1990.
There is a reason why they came later. Australian Open switched from grass to rebound ace, and the first tournament was in 88. I lost to Cash in the semifinals in 5 sets, and then next 2 years I was able to win. And I wish it was always on rebound ace or hard court like it is now.
There is one notable omission on the incredible CV of Ivan Lendl. In 14 attempts, he was never able to capture the Wimbledon men's singles title, played on the hallowed grass of the All England Club.
At the time, I think most of the great champions had the dragon they couldn't slay, frame it in however terms you want. You know, McEnroe never won the French, Connors never won the French, and for Lendl, that was Wimbledon.
It was an obsession, and maybe given who Lendl was, it became an exceptional obsession because that was Lendl.
He really tailored his game to win Wimbledon and hired special coaches and worked on the grass in the United States before coming over here.
I tried to do everything I can and to win. Unfortunately, I didn't, but I lose no sleep over that, and people think I do.
That's absolutely fantastic.
If you ask him, I think he tried to do his best. And Ivan was almost there, 2 finals.
Not only did I make 2 finals, I made 5 other semifinals on top of that. And in many ways, that's probably better. The opponents I played, the games they played, McEnroe serve and volley, Becker serve and volley, Edberg serve and volley, to achieve semifinals 7 times and 2 finals out of that is probably bigger achievement than the US Open finals 8 times. Unfortunately, that one thing is missing, but that's the way it is.
He conquered the world and became one of the best players. was an amazing achievement.
8 Grand Slams, 270 weeks at number one. No question, he's a top echelon player.
His legacy as a player has more to do with, again, the way he approached the process of the game, the fitness, the work ethic. He took being a pro's pro to a whole new level.
People who admire his tennis and his courage, you know, they respected him then and they're respecting him now.
You know, they say that he changed the game in the 80s. I don't think he's done yet. So over a 45 or 50 year span, Ivan Lendl will have many, many impacts on the game at very many levels.
Any regrets?
Didn't win enough. Always want to win more.